Good morning, students. Welcome to my lecture on modern literary criticism. Today, we are going to discuss on cultural studies and John Fiske's television culture. This is very important topic we have to discuss in the modern literary criticism. First of all, we will go through cultural studies. Then we will discuss about John Fiske. And then we will move on to the main topic of today's discussion, that is television culture, the book written by John Fiske. So we need to understand what cultural study is in the beginning. Cultural studies, which begins somewhere in the year 1990s, and it is somehow a kind of intellectual and interdisciplinary in form. You see, it has connection with different branches of, you see, literature, philosophy, natural sciences, and many more subjects are there intertwined together, and there is a kind of a process of analysis is there regarding our society, community, and culture. So here, the study of popular culture, especially in conjunction with the political problematic of identity and difference. So you see, different cultural groups are living around this world, and they have their own identities. And in this group, basically, there is a relationship between the higher and the lower. And this relationship is very crucial, because the lower or subjugated one is dominated for years, and they are struggling to get back their identity, or they are struggling to or forging their identity. So in this struggle, this culture helps them identify the group. So cultural studies uncovers here the relationship among aesthetic, anthropological, and political economic aspect of cultural production and reproduction. So different artifacts, different cultural elements have been produced over the period of time, and they define our cultural groups. So here, cultural study uncover the threads of all these artifacts and all these elements which are, you say, representing the society. In cultural studies, inquiry begins by questioning the common understanding, beliefs, and histories that shape our world. Like you see, different religious beliefs are there, different philosophies are there, different teachings are there, and they claim about the origin of the world. They claim about origin of a certain group. They claim about certain tradition, and all these traditions form a social group. So cultural study started questioning all those bases, and they tries to unveil the reality behind all these traditions. Cultural studies also explores constructions of race, class, ability, citizenship, gender, sexuality in their effort to understand the structures and practices of domination, resistance that shape contemporary society. Our societies in different parts of the world, in different continents, may it be in Asia, like in India, like in America, like in Europe. So everywhere there is a struggle between societies are going on. Like in India, you say caste system is there in practice for thousands of years. In Europe, there is a racial problem between whites and blacks is there. So there are different subject matters are there of related to marginality, subjugation. So here, subjugation of a particular community, subjugation of women, subjugation of particular race is there. So here, this particular study of cultural study explore the relationship and the constructions of the all these system of the world. Here, we need to go through very importantly the definition of Richard Johnson. He says the study of historical forms of consciousness or the subjectivity. Okay, so for Richard Johnson, cultural studies is the study of historical forms of consciousness and subjectivity. So you see, we are all classed or we are categorized into different social groups, and we do carry that identity. So here, Richard Johnson offers us the definition that here, cultural study go through or explores the consciousness of the historical forms. So here, he further maintains it must decenter the text as an object of study. So here, the text which is given to us, now text may be in the form of a book, text may be in the form of a different narrative, and it has narration of a particular tradition, but that tradition which may support one group, or at the same time that narrative may be dominating and subjugating the other. And then there is a glorification under in the name of a particular text. There are so many epics are there around the world, and they are singing the culture and tradition of a particular nation. But the same narrative, but the same epic may carry certain elements of subjugation, and it might be glorifying that. So subtle glorification of all that, all these elements, okay, it need to be decentered, it need to be explored. So here you see the cultural scientists, they took help from different, theories like structuralism, post-structuralism, deconstruction, psychoanalytic theory, anthropological theories, and applying all this theory to a particular text narrative, and they tried to unveil or they tried to expose the structure of hegemony behind it. Cultural studies views closure not as fixed, bounded, stable, and discrete entities, but rather as constantly interacting and changing sets of practices and processes. Here we need to understand that culture is not a fixed, it is a dynamic one. Culture is continuously progressing, it is developing, and it is taking shapes in different, era, and it comes up with different tradition. And this is the reason why it is constantly interacting and changing sets of practices and processes. So we see that the practices at a certain time may not carry its form further. So it takes shape or it changes in the further century. It takes another shape, but it keeps the real thread or original thread as it is. Cultural studies has a commitment to an ethical evaluation of modern society. This is very important idea. Cultural studies has a commitment to an ethical evaluation of modern society. Now, ethically, it go around the concept welfare. Now you see, there are different narratives are there, which are talking about the development of a community, development of societies. But here see, under the name of development, there is a constant subjugation of a particular community is there, or subjugation particular group is there. Or you see, there is a sidelining of a particular, element is there. And this is the reason why cultural study is ethically evaluating the entire system, especially cultural formations, cultural elements which are applied to the different tradition. So here, cultural study offers a very systematic method or systematic analysis of evaluating the modern society. Cultural studies begins with two important philosophers, Raymond Williams and Richard Hogarth. So here you see Hogarth's very important seminal book, The Uses of Literacy. For example, it entered into the debate over Americanization. Now here, Hogarth was exploring the idea of Americanization and using a close textual analysis to ask whether the new forms of popular culture were unsettling the established relation between working class cultural practices and the pattern of everyday life of working classes. So here, taking example of a working class in the America, he is talking about the idea and he debates over the idea of Americanization. So with this, you see the idea of cultural study begins focusing upon a particular aspect of culture. Another philosopher and literary critic Raymond Williams, in his book Culture and Society, which was published in 1958, and another book, The Long Revolution, which was published in 1965. And in other books also, he throughout his career sought the theoretical and methodological tools that would allow for description of the concrete relations among cultural practices, social relations, and organization of power. So here, Raymond Williams focuses upon different cultural practices around the world. Then he discusses and he analyzes the social relationship between people, between the different cultural groups, between the societies, and between communities. And then he discusses about the organization of power. So you see, there is a ladder of power is there. Like in India, you see caste system is there. And in the caste system, four varnas, ladder of four varnas, or typical Indian hierarchy is there. Like at the top, there is a Brahmin, then there is a Kshatriya, then there is a Vaishya, and at the lower, they kept Shudra. And then there are Atishudra, which are kept outside this, you say, body of hegemony. So in this way, the relationship between these groups, socio-political relationship, economical relationship, cultural relationship, traditional relationship, there are a variety of aspects of there through which, you see, Raymond Williams focuses upon the power relationship. Okay, and in this way, he exposes the hegemonical power. He exposes the idea how hegemonical powers or capitalistic power, using their, you see, influences, how do they dominate the subordinate classes. Here you see the term cultural studies, very first it was used by Richard Hogarth in 1964 when he established Center for Contemporary Cultural Studies at the University of Birmingham. And in the book The Empire Strikes Back, it's a very important book written by him in 1982, it influences the cultural study in 20th century. So you see, cultural study influences different academic, discipline. And this particular book is quite influential on different, you say, aspect of cultural studies under different disciplines. And with this, you see, in cultural studies, there are certain different terminologies are popular. And first one is Raymond Williams' cultural materialism. Now here you say, cultural materialism aspect of taken from Marx materialism or Marxism. Here, cultural materialism talks about the superstructure. Then second term is Stephen Greenblatt's cultural poetics. Now here, cultural poetics talks about literary production. And then Mikhail Bakhtin's cultural prosaics. It is also discusses the different, literary texts. And then John Fiske coined the term power block. Now power block is none other than the structure of, power groups. Okay, structure of power groups. In his book, Culture and Society, Raymond Williams speaks of consequences of making a distinction between culture and society on one hand and high and low culture on the other hand. So here you see in the book, he specifically focuses upon culture and society individually. And then he discusses about the high and low culture. And then he discusses about the power relationship between these two cultures. In Marxism and Literature, book published in 1977, William deals with ideology of cultural materialism, stating how economic forces influences the production of literary text. So here see, literary text is not a book only. Literary text may be into different narrative forms, and these different narrative forms are influenced of economic forces. Now here, Kenneth Womack defining the cultural materialism. He says, it is that as a cultural artifact, literature functions as a means for subverting social and political norms. So here you see, there are many ways literary texts, they functions for subverting or overthrowing social and political norms. So you see, some text has been used as a propaganda, and these propaganda, you say, influences the masses, and in this way they overthrow the set, you say, social and political norm. There is a vice versa situation is also there. So registering powers are also there from the marginal group, and they also comes up with their own idea of resistance to, get equality or equal status. In this, discussion of cultural study, Gramsci's theory of hegemony is a groundbreaking one, because here Gramsci talks about the hegemony of classes or power, a power block. So here Gramsci's historical leadership or hegemony involves the formation of alliances between class factions and struggles within the cultural realm of everyday common sense. So here you see there are the alliances of class factions are there. Okay, so there are power, power groups are there, and they have their alliances. And then there are struggles within the cultural realm of everyday common sense. The theory of hegemony facilitated the analysis of the ways subordinate groups actively resist and respond to the political and economic dominion. Now here you see, while discussing about the power structure and hegemony, structure of the society, here you see, at the same time, the subordinated group, they are constantly in struggle for the ages, okay? And they respond to the political and economic dominion in their way. So here, Gramsci also gives focus upon these resisting forces as to how they are struggling to get along with the situation and to overcome it. The subordinate groups needed not to be seen merely as the passive dupes of the dominant class and its ideology. So here you see, though dominant class are dominating the social structure for ages, in spite of that, we cannot say or we cannot see a marginalized group or subordinate group, they are passive in nature. You see, some or the other way, they are struggling. They are resisting the dominant forces. Like we see, that in case of gender studies, we see that there is a feminist movement, radical feminist movement is going on. And this radical feminist movement is constantly resisting the patriarchal culture. And they are trying to get, or they are trying to acquire equal status in the society. So in this way, we cannot say that the subordinate groups or marginalized groups are passive in nature. So this is what Gramsci's idea. He see they are quite active. Then, after discussing this brief idea of cultural study, now we need to understand the writer, John Fiske. John Fiske is a media scholar and media critic and a cultural theorist. We can see that John Fiske is one of the first media scholar. And he talks about different media, and he works as a media critic. He is also called as the father of television studies, because he explored different television serials, episodes, and then he analyzed them, introducing or applying different theories. And then he tried to unveil or try to expose the very mechanism of this television culture. Fiske was educated in Britain, and then he became a professor, and then he taught throughout the world, including Australia, New Zealand, and US, United States of America. He was also a professor of professor emeritus in Department of Communication Arts at the University of Wisconsin Madison in USA. Fiske is considered one of the first scholars applying semiotics to media texts following the tradition of post-structuralism, and coined the term semiotic democracy. So here you see, I have already mentioned how John Biscay applied different theories on television, you said telecast, and he tried to understand the meanings behind all those aspects of you say serials and episode run throughout the period. So you see, John Biscay take element of radio, which was introduced in 1920s, 30s, and then he go on to the time when television was introduced in early 40s. So how television, how radio episodes were adopted into television, and then from black and white television to color television, and then television becomes a tool for politicians and hegemonic forces. So here John Biscay explore the entire time and shifting from radio to the television, and then simultaneously he discusses about the film. Okay, although film is a different genre, here you see John Biscay focuses mainly upon the television. Talking about cultural studies, it often concerns itself with the agency at the level of the practice of everyday life. Approaches such research from a standpoint of radical contextualism. Now here, John Biscay observes in his book, Understanding Popular Culture. Here he maintained, because culture relates to social system and to its power structure, culture is inherently political in nature. So you see, whatever culture is introduced in society that has a political motive to control the society, to control the entire group. Culture is also a constant process of producing meaning of and from our social experience, which produces social identity. So you see, culture also gives us a way to produce a meaning of our social experiences. Now we are passing through different ages. Now you say from ancient, or you say prehistoric time to the historic time, and then ancient to the medieval, and from medieval to modern. So you see, human societies are progressing from time immemorial to us to the present time. So in this way, human beings are interpreting their experiences. So although in the earliest time the interpretation was difficult because they did not know, or the previous human being or the historical human being, they did not have different sciences, different disciplines to understand the experience they do have. But today we are having different disciplines to understand our experiences. So there are scientific investigations are there to understand our experiences. So in this way, culture is constant process of understanding meaning out of our experiences. So all the meaning that are produced in our particular culture are in context of a particular social system, which is stratified and dominated by certain groups like whites, males, capitalists, etc. So you see, our societies is categorized. So you go to different part of the world, each subcontinent will have this hierarchy of dominion. So there are black and white, you say hierarchy is there. Then patriarchy, in the patriarchy, males are at the superior position and females are at the subordinate position. Then in the capitalist society, rich and poor is there. And then there is a caste system is there. And in there, certain caste are superior, certain caste are, you see, subordinated. So in this way, so all meaning are produced in our particular culture. So in this way, so meaning are produced, are introduced in the different setup of the culture. This is what the idea of John Biscay. Then the dominant ideology emerged from such categories affect the preferred or dominant culture readings of media text. And then media text has its own narratives. But here media narrative is highly dominated by, you say, dominant ideologies. Now dominant ideologies are related to a particular nation, Okay, and obviously that dominant ideology related to the particular group of men living in that country. Now here, John Fiske differentiate between mass culture and the cultural products put out by an industrialized capitalist society and popular culture, the ways in which people use, abuse, subvert these products to create their own meaning and meanings. So here you see, John Fiske gives us differentiation between the mass culture and cultural products. So mass culture is practices by the people, and cultural products are different artifacts, different, you say, elements produced out of culture. So here this relationship is very important. And this relationship is defined on the terms of industrialized capitalist society and a popular culture. So obviously, you see, many a time we go through a television serial and we often get advertisement. So here, advertisement comes up with particular product, okay? But that product has been introduced as, or you say, as a native one or a cultural one. Like you say, in India, Amazon is there. Amazon basically is American, you say, company, limited company. You say online marketing company. But here you see one of the advertisement, you see one of the character. Now he wanted to pay a bill and his friend suggests him, why don't you pay the bill via Amazon? And he says, Apana Amazon. So in this way, the particular company, I mean, shown as Apana by a character. So in this way, the cultural product, which was, sale or which was introduced on television serial, which was under the cover of, you say, the native one. Then, rather than focusing on a mass culture's attempt to dominate and homogenize, he preferred to look at popular culture's evasion and manipulations of these attempts. So here you see, the popular culture, whichever it is, it attempts to dominate and homogenize. So here, John Fiske prefers to look at popular culture's evasions and manipulations of these attempts. Okay, so popular culture has a certain manipulation to popularize this product, or popularize particular ideology, popularize particular opinion. So in this way, mass culture has that attempt. With this, now we have gone through a little brief idea of cultural study and aspect of cultural study of John Fiske. And after this, we will move on to the seminal book, Television Culture, which is the subject of study for us today. This book has been, you see, divided into 16 chapters. Last chapter is conclusion. 16 chapter is the conclusion. And in the beginning, John Fiske talks about the production of television serials or television programs. Okay, he involves the setup, it involves the camera, it involves different elements to produce a tele serial. And then he move on to different meanings, different aspects which are related to the production of any teleprogram or television program. And finally, he comes to certain conclusion on the basis of his observations and his analysis. And for analysis, John Fiske certainly do take help from different theories, different cultural theories, different language theories, anthropological theories, and different literary and philosophical theories. So obviously, structuralism, post-structuralism, deconstruction, then psychoanalytic criticism. Then he take example or thoughts of some writers and exponent of theories like Claude Lévi-Strauss, Jacques Lacan, Derrida, Ferdinand de Saussure, Sigmund Freud. Then there is a so many line of writers, Giulio Cristeva of intertextuality. He takes many examples. He borrows different theories. He borrows ideas to apply on different teleseries to understand the mechanism, to understand the structure of that serials. And then he categorized public-oriented serials and commercial serials, public-oriented televisions and commercial televisions. So in this way, what are the aspects of public-oriented television and what are the aspects of commercial television and commercial teleserials? So here, in this way, he go on analyzing the aspect of this, you say, classes of television. In the beginning of the book, you see, writer John Fiske clears his approach. Now, he has two important approach in this book, Television and Culture. Number one, television as a bearer and provoker of meanings and pleasure. So we switch on a television. So obviously it is to understand, to enjoy meanings and obviously get pleasure out of it. So this is what everyone else's approach to the television, which is upheld by John Fiske. And then second approach of this book to understand of culture as the generation and circulation of this variety of meanings and pleasures within the society. So you see, different generations are living in a particular age, and we pass through time. And here we see we have different meanings to different, you say, traditions, different, you say, ideas. And here John Fiske is exploring all those, you say, aspect of culture as the generation and circulation. Now here, television for John Fiske is a culture. And it is a crucial part of the social dynamics by which the social structure maintains itself in a constant process of production and reproduction. Now here, television is also taken as very important tool or media as the mode of social dynamics. And in this way, a social structure has been maintained. So you see, every nation has a particular social system and dominant social system. And certainly a dominant class wanted to maintain that social structure. And in this way, he uses television as the media to upheld that social system. And in this way, television becomes a medium for the class to regulate or to, you say, popularize the social form. Okay, like we can take example of Indian popular serials like Mahabharata, Ramayana, Chandrakanta. So it is based on Indian mythology, Indian scriptures. And in this way, through these serials, a social system, a social setup, which is known for India or which is identical to India, it has been popularized or, you say, projected in the society through these serials. Now here, John Fiske, before again going into detail of his analysis of the television culture, he maintains about the focus of the book. Now, what is the focus of his book? The problem of how the textuality of television is made meaningful and pleasurable by its variously situated viewers. Now here, television serial is obviously made keeping in mind its viewer, and viewers are sitting elsewhere. Now, in the earliest time, some 30 years ago, a television serial was restricted to a particular location or particular region. Now, teleserials are open, okay? And now they are premiered or they are shown worldwide. So any serial, if it is made in America, so it is open for the entire world. So in this way, the horizon of television serial has been broadened to the world now. Earlier, it was quite restricted. So in this way, keeping in mind viewer, okay. So which viewer? Now tele serial producers are keeping in their mind, that is important. Okay, so here John Fiske is discussing about that. The second one is the relationship between this cultural dimension and television status as a commodity in a capitalist economy. Now here you see television is highly exploited for the promotion of, you say, capitalist economy. And in this way, different cultural, you say, elements, tradition has been exploited or taken into consideration to promote the capitalist economy. So even you take any serial or any, you say, quiz or any sports on teleserials, so they are capitalist economy oriented. Okay, so behind every serial, although they are talking about culture or they are talking about particular aspect of, you say, society, folklore, in spite of that, there is always their economy involved, and that too from capitalist economy. So obviously John Fiske is focusing upon this aspect of capitalist economy works or runs through the teleserials. Now here again, John Fiske sees television as a cultural agent, particularly as a provoker and circulator of meanings. Okay, so obviously it is again a kind of a propaganda, or it is also kind of a media or medium to propagate meaning, to circulate meaning. So in this way, it is a kind of a provoker. John Fiske, in the beginning of his chapter, in the introductory chapter, he talks about the codes of television on three different levels. So on the first level, there is a reality. Okay, so in case of reality, the teleserials and episodes and narratives are, you say, formed or you say made in such a way that it has a close connection with reality. And to maintain it, then appearances of character, dress code, makeups, environment, behavior, speech, gesture, expression, sound, etc., etc., has been used or utilized. So in this way, if Ramayana serial is there, so Ram will appear in a particular attire, in a particular, you say, dress, okay, or particular makeup. So in this way, teleserial is trying to go close to the reality. On the second level, there is a representation of the teleserial. And for representation, the mediums are camera, lighting, editing, music, sound. Okay, so camera will be used. Okay, so close shot. Okay, then distance shot. Then color lighting, day lighting, night lighting. And then there involves editing. And then background music is there. Different sounds are utilized to, you say, give a real situation or to give it a real setup. And on the third level, there is ideology. In case of teleserial, which are organized into coherence and social acceptability by the ideological codes, such as those of individualism, patriarchy, race, class, materialism, capitalism, etc., etc. So you see, every serial has its own idea to promote or to circulate. Okay. And it may be individualism. Certain character serials are there. Then upholding patriarchy through different serials aired in the daytime. Okay. So in this way, patriarchy has been promoted. Then race or racial issues, class, issues related to class, materialism. Okay, as maintained or you say critiqued in the Marxism, and then the capitalism. So these are all ideological elements are there, or these are the ideologies. Okay. And teleserials are promoting these ideologies. Okay. Then what are the choices are left for cameraman? Cameraman is a very important element in the teleserial because he is capturing the moment. For example, to give meaning to what is being photographed are limited and specifiable. Okay, they consist of framing, focus, distance, movement, camera placing, angle, lens choice. So these are the different aspects of cameraman to maintain the certain meaning. The representational convention by which women are shown to lack knowledge which men possess and give to them is an example of the ideological code of patriarchy. So in this way, in the patriarchy, women has been shown having little knowledge, and opposite to that, men were shown clever, men were shown intelligent. So in this way, the situation of teleserial while capturing it, okay, it will maintain this. Okay, so these are the code which are used by the producers and directors. Now, camera work in detail discussed by John Fiske in this book, in a chapter independently. The camera is used through angle, deep focus to give us perfect view of scene and thus complete understanding of it. So camera gives us the whole picture, whole scenario. Like you see, we are watching a match, cricket match. Okay, so at one instant, the entire ground has been shown. At one instant, the bowler has been shown, and then the batsman has been shown. So in this way, while capturing live moment, it has a way of capturing it. So similarly, in case of a teleserial is there, so that way the camera will focus upon the situation. So in this way, there are some conventions are introduced to use the camera. Okay, so there are two important sources of conventions are there. Number one, the social code of interpersonal distance. In Western cultures, the space within 24 inches of us is encoded as private. So we see sometimes hero, heroine, they are talking to each other. So if the distance between them is within 24 inches or within 60 centimeter, so you can consider this is a very private discussion between them. And then there is the other sources lies in the technical codes, which imply that seeing close meaning, seeing better, see through the someone's word. Okay, so someone's dialogue is there. On the basis of that dialogues, that discussions, conversation, you can get hold of the idea about the narrator or the speaker. See, you can identify he is a hero or he is a villain. Okay, so the hero and the antagonist were shown through their discussions and the activity. Then different elements of capturing a moment in the serial is there, like lighting. The hero's cabin is lit in a soft yellowish light and that of the villain in a harsh and whiter one. So obviously, to project a hero, a very soft light has been shown, and in this way, the hero has been projected. And opposite to that, a villain has been projected in a very harsh light, okay, in a yellowish light. And in this way, from the beginning, we have developed aversion to it. Then, second element is there, editing. So here you see, in case of editing, the more time has been given to hero to explain, to maintain his dialogue, whereas villain has been given less time. Okay. So in this way, to give more explanation, convincing the other character situation. So in this way, time has been given to hero more than the villain. Then the third element is the music. Okay, now here music linking the two scenes started in a major key and changed to minor as the scene changed to the villain. So in this way, music play a very important role in introducing characters. So a very softer and dramatic music when the hero heroines are introduced, and a very, you say, dangerous and something, you say, suspense music had been introduced when a villain has been introduced. So in this way, music play a very vital role in creating the scenes and the situation. Then the casting is there, casting of the characters. Then actors and actresses who are cast to play hero, heroines, villain, villainess, and supporting roles are real people whose appearances is already encoded by our social code. So obviously, the hero and heroine are not away from the reality. So even you see modern cinema bring forth some aliens. None of us have seen aliens so far. But whenever aliens are projected in the movie, they are close to human being. They are structurally shown like human being. They also have a face, they have a torso and limbs. So in this way, in case of casting, you say, these are the code which are already accepted in society. They are, adopted in the teleserials. In case of setting and costume, again, there is a difference between hero and heroine. So hero and heroine's cabin is larger than that of the villain. So villain will be shown in a particular, a deserted, bungalow or deserted some motor shop. Okay, whereas hero will be shown in a particular good house or in a particular location. So these are the differences maintained, the identities of the character. Then the makeup, the same merging of ideological codes of morality, attractiveness and heroism, villainy, and their condensation into a material social code. So hero will be shown something good, like in India, Amitabh Bachchan will be shown a very good, good looking with good clothing. At the same time, Amrish Puri, his antagonist, in the movie, will be shown some bald and having something different clothing, you know. So in this way, hero and the villain, they are maintained with makeup and kept identical to their role. Then the action, a difference between the two is that of the cooperation and closeness. The hero and heroine cooperate and come physically closer together. The villain and villainess, on the other hand, disagree and pull apart physically. So in this way, this kind of a relationship has been shown. So hero and heroine, they are constantly coming together. Though there is a episode, and in that episode, hero and heroine, they go apart from each other out of misunderstanding. But then misunderstanding will be solved soon, and again heroine come back to the hero. But here, the villain is, once upon a time, he was a close friend to the hero, or he was known to hero, then he's going away from him. And at one point in time, they become, enemy to each other, and they want to kill each other. So in this way, this action has been there. Hero, heroine, they're coming together. Hero, villain, they are going apart from each other. So this is what the mechanism of action is there, as pointed out by John Fiske. Then the dialogue. Obviously, whenever the hero will come there, he will gain the sympathy of the audience and viewers. And whenever the villain is there, he is making his dialogue. So he will influencing the masses, and we are, it's kind of a repulsive one. Okay, we started, hating the hero, the way he appears. So in this way, dialogues are maintained in such a way that hero will gain sympathy and villain will gain, hatred from the audiences. Then the ideological codes are used in teleserials. These codes and television codes which bring them to the viewer are both deeply embedded in ideological codes of which they are themselves the bearer. So obviously, different ideological codes has been borrowed from the society. So ideological codes which are alien to us, which will not be ever practiced in the telesphere. So acceptable ideological codes will be implemented or will be borrowed or will be introduced in the teleserial. This is what the idea here. So here, to understand television, we need to see it and its program as potential of meaning rather than as commodities. Now you see, teleserial is obviously is a commodity, but on the one hand, priority we see, it gives us meaning, or we see some serial for its meaning, like certain serials based on mythological stories. So we see that serial for getting meaning out of it rather than considering it as a commodity. A text is different matter altogether. Like programs are produced, distributed, and defined by the industry, and texts are products of their readers. You see, the programs are implemented, or programs are run in the television, okay, and it is distributed and defined by the industry. So how to produce serial, what will be its influence, what will be its end target, that has been decided by the producers. Whereas text is the product of reader. Okay, like in modern criticism, like Death of the Author, Rolla Bach has maintained or claimed. So here you see, now it is the reader who is born and who is giving meaning to the text. Okay, so this is the difference between teleserial or program and a text. So a program became a text at the moment of reading. So you see, there is a possibility that the program itself turned as a text, because obviously it is based on a certain script. Okay, sometimes a program has been based on a certain book or certain text, certain narrative, and in this way program itself became a kind of a text for the reading. Discourses function not only in the production of reading of text, but also in making sense of social experiences. For example, a particular discourse of a gender. You see, sometimes a gender discourse is there in teleserial, like there is a debate or discussion is organized, a program is there. And in that case, you see, a gender discussion means feminism has been projected. So here, while projecting that particular, gender discourse or gender debate, so here, social experience, or in making of a sense of social experience, is kept at, primary level. Then John Fiske moved on to discuss on an essential characteristics of television is its polysemy and multiplicity of meaning. So you see, teleserial doesn't yield into a single meaning, but it has a multiplicity of meaning. And this, in this way, it traps different viewers from different classes. So a single serial is obviously projected to encash different viewership. So every viewer from different class will identify themselves, or they will find pleasure in the serial of their own. So in this way, the serial, teleserial, has a multiplicity of meaning, or this is the reason why John Fiske called it as a polysemy. Now here, John Fiske talks about a textual study of television, which involves three four key. Number one, formal qualities of television programs and their flow. Okay, now it is a formal quality of television program and its flow. Second one is the intertextual relationship of television within itself and with other media and with conversation. So you see, many a program are there which have a connection with different programs, different, movies, different books. So in this way, intertextual connection has been maintained. Then the third focus is there, the study of socially situated readers and process of reading. So you see, in different social class, different social groups are living. And in this way, they are become the subject matter for the serial. Okay. And in this way, teleserial gives us a kind of a platform for the study of that particular aspect of you say cultural group. Now here, Bourdieu's metaphor of cultural capital has been discussed by John Fiske in this book. Now what Bourdieu's metaphor of cultural capital is? A society's culture is as unequally distributed as its material wealth, and that like material wealth, it serves to identify class interest and to promote and naturalize the class differences. Now here you see, class has unequal system. Okay, it has a hierarchy. And this is the reason why the material wealth of the society is unequally distributed. Thus, those cultural form which a society considered to be high, for example, classical music, fine art, literature, ballet, coincide with the test of those with the social power, whereas lowbrow or mass cultural forms appeal to those ranked low on the social structure. So in this way, there are certain social, cultural forms are there which are related to certain, groups, okay, like classical music, classical art, certain traditional, celebrations. So these are related to certain classes, but at the same time, there are some popular, cultures are there which are related to low classes. So in this way, on the basis of the culture, on the basis of a tradition, you can identify the social class and their interest. And in this way, these traditions also have been classified as a high and the low. So this theory of cultural capital explains the social function of culture as a provision of a system of meanings and pleasure. So you see, different artifacts, different element of culture, they are taken as the cultural capital. They are taken as a cultural, like a classical music is a cultural capital. Okay, so in this way, that underwrites the social system structured around economic class and other forms of social power. So in this way, the cultural capital is related to a certain, social group, and it identifies it. And in this way, it promotes the same. Next, popular culture capital is an accumulation of meaning and pleasure that serves the interest of subordinated and powerless, or rather the disempowered, for few social groups are utterly without power. Now there are certain popular cultural capitals are there, or certain programs are there, which are, focused upon powerless. Okay, like gender studies, debates, discussion, or certain serials are there, which are, focusing upon this subordinated group. Or serial has claiming that it is to, promote equality, or it is safeguarding a particular social group. So in this way, with this claim, serial came. So in this way, popular cultural capital is at the center and discussing the powerless. This popular cultural capital requires a set of cultural competencies to read it. Now, cultural competencies involve a critical understanding of a text and the conventions by which it is constructed. Now, when we say gender studies, so obviously, when we talk about gender studies, we go through the feminism aspect of feminism, or supporting the equality to women. So in this way, it involves certain critical, measures to understand certain, tradition, how women has been subordinated. Okay, so in this way, a gender study is entirely based upon certain cultural competences supporting a particular, group. Then, realism has been very important in case of teleserials or television. Okay, now what are the aspects of realism? John Fiske has found through the serials is this. Now he maintained, we can call television an essentially realistic medium because of its ability to carry a socially convincing sense of the real. Now here, all the real facts and events has been captured to make the program real. Like you see in Indian serials. Okay, now serials are aired throughout the year and it go on years. Sometimes some serials are longest. Okay, like CID serial of Sony TV, I mean aired for about 20 years. So in this way, while making the serials, they are made quite real with introducing certain ceremonies and festivities. Like whenever serials are coming in between festival of Holi. So obviously one of the episode will be based on the Holi. So all the characters are celebrating Holi. And then there is a problem, I mean, dealt with the characters. Then we move on. Then there is a Eid is there and serials will taking up the subject of Eid and social relationship under this celebration. Then there is a Diwali. Okay, so in this way, all these elements has been taken. Okay, and on the basis of that, the serial has been made to make it real one. Then second aspect is there. This view of television realism is often expressed by the metaphors of transparency and reflection. Television is seen either as a transparent window on the world or as a mirror reflecting our own reality back to us. So television is a kind of a mirror which shows our face, our behavior. So in this way, it is an eye-opener one. So through realism, teleserial gives us the real picture of our society. And you see that this is the reason why John Fiske says television produces reality rather than reflects it. Okay, so in this way, it reflects reality to us itself. Okay, then realism is typically narrative in form because teleserial runs on the basis of a narration. A story has been narrated. Or every episode is based on certain narrative. Even a photo or a realistic painting is a frozen moment in a narrative. Like we say, still moment is there in a painting. Like we struck with certain painting hung on a wall. So it has a narrative. It has a story within it. So in this way, a teleserial also comes up with a particular narration. Okay, and that narration has an aspect of opinion in it. Now here, in one of the chapter, John Fiske discusses realism and radicalism. Now here, realism is inevitably reactionary. It finally represents the world to us in a way that naturalizes the status quo, that promotes the naturalizes the dominant ideology. You see, a particular social system has been, you say, practiced in a particular nation for thousands of years. Okay. And there is a struggle to maintain the status quo. Okay. A dominant class, which is enjoying the power, does not want to lose it. And on the other hand, there is a powerless group is there, a subordinate group is there, resisting for thousands of years to get equality. Okay. But here, very importantly, the forces, dominant forces, will try to regulate, will try to, popularize different culture through the media of television, okay, in the form of realism to maintain the status quo. And in this way, it affects the ideology of a dominant class. Now here, radicalism means a critical interrogation of a dominant ideology and of the social system. So obviously you see dominant ideology, capitalism are going along their ideology. They want to maintain status quo and enjoy their power. They enjoy their status. But at the same time, there is a constant dichotomy is there. Now the subordinate class, they are struggling with their ideology to get equality. So they comes up radically. Okay, they comes up with a radical movement or radical, you say, force. So here, this radical force is also a kind of a element of discussion through the teleserial. Now, realism involves a fidelity both to physical, sensually perceived details of the external world and to the values of the dominant ideology. In this way, ideology is mapped onto the objective world of reality, and the accuracy of realism's representation of the details of the real world becomes the validation of the ideology it has been made to bear. So obviously, realism has been handled as a tool or a media, okay, to propagate a particular ideology, okay, and most of the time a dominant ideology or capitalism has been promoted. Although some serials or some, you say, channels, they claim they are supporting or safeguarding certain subordinated groups, or you say marginalized groups. Okay. What John Fiske see television is as a popular cultural media, because through teleserial, different cultural elements has been propagated, or they are aired and circulated amongst the consumers. And here it involves the economics that determine its production and distribution demand that it reaches a mass audience. Obviously, while producing a certain serial, okay, so the prime object is to earn money out of it. Okay, so producers and directors will certainly see that investors will come there. Okay, so the way the serial acquires popularity amongst masses, producers and director may be able to get more advertisement from capitalist, you say, promoters. So in this way, this relationship is there. On one hand, we see television as a cultural medium, but on the other hand, you see, the object of this teleserial is to earn, and obviously it has certain capitalist interests. Now, television is also, John Fiske see, as conventional medium. Its convention suits both the audiences with their needs for familiarity and routinization, and the producers for established conventions, not only keeping the cost of production down, they also minimize the risk in the marketplace. Now here, the audience and producer, they are at the two end. Producers will always think of reducing the production cost of a particular serial, and obviously will think of earning more out of it. And viewer obviously visit the teleserial to identify themselves, to get pleasure, or to draw meaning which is, I mean, suitable to their understanding. So in this way, viewers are not one. Viewers is not one. There are multiple viewers are there coming from different, you say, groups or different classes. And in this way, it is a kind of a circus for producer to make his serial appealing to each and every classes. Okay, so in this way, different conventions has been used in the teleserials to make it, you say, suitable to all the viewers. And at the same time, it becomes, you say, economical to the producers. Television news is there. Apart from the serials and programs, news is very important, you say, aspect, and many people enjoyed it. Or news is almost, I mean, the part of daily routine that we have to have sit before television for news. Now here, sometimes television news will often include radical voices, spokespeople from trade unions, from peace demonstrator, from environmentalists, but these will be controlled doses whose extent and positioning in the news story will be chosen by the agent of the dominant ideology. You see, obviously certain event will be discussed or narrated as a news, and then different defenders will be, you see, invited there to talk on the event or express their opinion. But all these opinions are controlled through the dominant ideology. So in this way, while all the discussions will be going on, but at the end, dominant ideology will be held, you say, at the top. So everything else will be controlled under this dominant ideology. This is what the propaganda of news, as John Fiske sees. So whenever you see or whenever you watch a particular news channel, and news channel presenters, okay, when reporters are presenting certain event, and they are discussing, they are gathering a discussions from different opinions at the same time, the dominant ideology or the sole ideology will be kept at the top level, or it is the center and around which all the other voices are subordinated. Okay, so in this way, a kind of a circus is there for telemakers, okay, especially news channels, to maintain dominant ideology at the supreme position. Hegemony characterizes social relations as a series of struggles for power. The dominant ideology working through the form of the text can be registered, evaded, and negotiated with in varying degrees by differently social situated readers. Now here you see, the hegemony is always there playing its role through the dominant ideology. Okay, and dominant ideology promoters, they won't leave their power. Okay, and in this way, the hegemonic structure will always there to maintain their ideology and opinion through the structure. But at the same time, this, you say, ideology has always been negotiated or has always been, you say, countered by the counter ideology. And sometimes it is through the readers or the viewers. So you see, sometimes viewers also comes up with their own dissent. This is what John Fiske is maintaining in this discussion. Next, John Fiske discuss about realism and discourse. Now here, realism shares many of the characteristics that Roland Barthes ascribes to myth, and these all stem from its being a discourse that hides its discursive nature and presents itself as natural rather than cultural. Now here, discourse is not only a product of culture. It is also, in industrialized societies at least, the product of society and the power of political relations within the society. So obviously, discourse is not only the product of culture, but it is also related to the industrialized society. So discourse will be transformed into a different kind of, you said, discussion. Okay. A discourse will always stem from a socially identifiable point and will serve the interest of a group around that point by making their sense of real appear common sense. Okay, so obviously discourse will have its connection with society and its problem. Okay, so problem will be there at the center and the discourse will be developed around it. So it's not always the dominant ideology at the stake, but sometimes you see subordinated groups also will come up with their own issue, subject matter, and discourse will be developing around it. Like you say, gay and lesbian subject, feminism is there, marginalized groups like Dalits are there, blacks are there. Okay, so in this way, there are line of, you say, marginalized groups are there, which has its own discourse, okay, to you say, maintain their struggle against the dominant ideology. Now here, John Fiske talks about television and its relationship with social change, as to how television helps for social change. Now the argument that television is always an agent of status quo are convincing, but not totally so. Okay, now here, television is, you say, always taken as the agent of status quo, convincing, but it is not that. Sometimes you see some program are there which are, you say, anti or counter to the dominant ideology or the status quo, because status quo will always marginalize the group, or subordination will always go on in this status quo, and this status quo has to be demolished so that equality is maintained. And in this way, some of the teleserial or some of the programs will be there to voice the the marginalized group. And in this way, social change has been, you say, has been one of the aspects of that serial. Social change in the industrial democracies rarely occur through revolution. Now, this is very important point John Fiske is making. Okay, now there was the time when Mahatma Gandhi and social revolutionaries were fighting against the imperialist nation like England. Okay, and they fetched in a freedom for us. Then there were revolutionaries like Dr. Ambedkar, Mahatma Phule. Now these were the people who fought against the hegemonical forces, powerful forces, and they tried to bring equality to the, you say, subordinated groups in the country. But you see, revolution in the context of modern societies like industrialized society is difficult, what John Fiske is seeing, which is the socio-political equivalent of the radical text. Rather, it occurs as a result of constant tension between those with the social power and subordinate groups trying to gain more power so as to shift social values toward their own interests. So you see, this relationship, okay, or this struggle relationship between these two groups become more radical these days, or become more, you say, bitter these days. You know, we have seen many, I mean, events becomes, you say, racial sometimes. Many of events becomes caste-based sometimes. And then there was a struggle is there between the two groups to maintain their own voice. So in this way, social change is not that easy in the industrialized society because it is always revolving around the capitalist society. And this is the reason why John Fiske found it, little difficult. The textual equivalent of this is the progressive text, where the discourses of social change are articulated in relationship with the meta discourse of the dominant ideology. He is talking about different texts and narratives, and through different narratives and different discourses, you see, progressive text is always, you say, collide with the dominant ideology. And this is what the struggle is going on in the field of, you say, knowledge. One of the chapter in the book, Television Culture, John Fiske, focuses upon the subject matter of the teleserial. Now here, the role of the subject as the central site of sense-making process has been given a lot of attention in recent critical theory in general. Now subject matter is very important in each discussion, whether it is a kind of a television genre. Okay, it has to have its subject matter. Now here, John Fiske gives he is exploring the theory of O'Sullivan. And O'Sullivan traces three main uses of the word subject. Number one, subject as a political theory. Okay, so what political theory suggests? It might be subject matter for a serial. Second one, subject as an idealist philosophy. Now, certain ideology is there, dominant ideology or ideology of subordinate people. Okay, so that kind of be. Ideology might be the subject matter for a particular serial. And then subject matter as the grammar. Now here, grammar is a kind of a articulation or kind of a structure for the whole formation of that opinion. Or you see subject as a grammar in case of that particular serial. Now here, John Fiske was what maintained our subjectivity is the product of social relations that works upon us in three main ways: through society, through language and discourse, and through psychic process. So you say our subjectivity related to social relations comes through three aspects. Number one, through society. So we learn many things from society. Okay, so obviously when there is a negotiation for meaning, it is coming from the society. Social norms, social interactions. Second one is through language and discourse. Okay, now certain event has happened. Okay, and we see that something has happened like this, like someone is murdered, but then next moment we come to television and we see there is a narrative is there, okay, discourse is there, and that discourse maintained this is what a caste victimization or racial victimization. So in this way a discourse is there, and in this way the meaning has been shifted into the another way of discussion. Then the third one is a psychic process. Now psychic process is the process for readers or viewers. Now they are getting this idea of psychic process of meaning. Now here the theory of subject proposes that as there are contradictions between agencies of society, so there will be contradictions in the subject. Now you see there are contradictions in the society or contradictions in the agencies of society. Now there are different agencies are there, like different social groups are there, and because of that the subject matter has yielded into or resulted into contradictions or different meaning. So what I see as a 6, you may see it as a 9. Okay, like one letter is written on the floor, I'm standing here, I could read it as a 6. You are standing on the other side and you are reading it as a 9. Okay, so we have our own vision and understanding about it, and it comes from our aspect and our approach to the society, and in this way meaning changes according to different social groups, and this is what the beginning of contradiction. Then the social subject. Television tries to construct an ideal subject position which it invites us to copy, occupy, and if we do, rewards us with the ideological pleasure that is provided by experiencing it. Is therefore the pleasure of recognition. In this way you see John Fiske talks about different television serials or programs. Sometimes you see some viewers identify their ideology with the serial, and in this way they get pleasure out of it. In this way social subject has been tapped, or social subject has been introduced in the program, and in this way pleasure is subject to the social subject and the viewer, and in this way relationship between the social subject and the viewers has been established. Now in case of psychoanalysis and the subject, now here John Fiske is discussing further, and it is relating with the psychoanalytic processes, how meaning is out of psychoanalytic processes by the viewer. Now here John Fiske maintained images of women and men on the television or film produce pleasure in viewer insofar as they allow the imagery to be grounded in the representation of real, like sometimes hero and heroine are presented in a situation, okay, like a hero is riding on bike and he's singing a song, okay, like jo mukaddar ka sikandar kehlayega, like Amitabh Bachchan was singing on a motorbike. So in this way it gives us pleasure, it gives a pleasure to reader. In this way different characters are projected, okay, it gives pleasure to audiences. So in this way different situation has been created to project particular character to give meaningful pleasures to the audiences. Then the imaginary, the subconscious, leisure and desires are all cultural construct, or at least cultural inflected, and are not unchanging and unchangeable aspect of human nature. So you see thousands of years ago, you go back, we have certain basic natures which are still following us, or we are still following, and through those basic natures, okay, we enjoy, or we, you say, become happy and draw pleasure out of spectacles. So in this way teleseries or television will air certain program, will certainly pick those aspect of baser instincts of pleasure from the human being to give pleasure to them. So obviously pleasure making or pleasure is the ultimate object of these television programs, and it works subconsciously for the viewers. Now while discussing about the subject matter, John Fiske talks about active audiences. Now, active viewers, those who are responding to the series. The social subject has a history, lives in a particular social formation, like a mixed class, gender, age, region, etc., and is constituted by a complex cultural history that is both social and textual. Okay, we need to understand here, a social subject has a history. Now, any social subject, okay, that may be related to gender studies, that may be related to some caste study, racial study, etc., etc., it has a history. And it lives in a particular social formation. Okay, so it lives in a particular social formation, like a class, gender, age, region, etc. And it's constituted by a complex cultural history that is both social and textual. So you see, we carry different social, events and texts which carry this discussion and discourses. The subjectivity results from real social experiences and from mediated a textual experience. So you see, some real episode, a real thing happens in life, and it has been adopted by writer. So a real social experience has been converted into textual experience. Okay. So in this way, subjectivity works. The actual television viewers is primarily social subject, because the story is related to us. Okay, whatever story is aired in television, in program, it is related to us. And this is the reason why television's viewers are real social subject of the teleseries. This subjectivity is more influential in the construction of meaning, because when viewers are identifying themselves with the subject, or when they identify themselves with certain characters, in that way also, or in that sense also, they may draw certain meaning out of it. Like sometimes you see some viewers do not identify themselves with a serial, or they don't identify the event. So they will obviously leave the program. They won't find it any relevant to them. There are so many programs out there which are not relevant to us. Why? Because we don't find any identical to us in that. This is what the relationship we have to understand from John Fiske maintained in this active audiences title. Now, meaning making. How do we make meaning? Now, reading the television text is a process of negotiation between this existing subject position and one proposed by the text itself. Okay. Now, yes, you see, one text has been adopted for the teleserial. Okay. And here, when a viewer is sitting before the program, he started making meaning out of it. And this is the process. Now, what is the mode of reception? How do we receive? The study of culture must not be confined to the readings of text. For the condition of a text reception necessarily become part of the meaning and pleasure it offers the viewers. Now, for television is essentially a domestic medium. The routine of living are part of the domestic routines by which home life is organized. Now, you go on different serials, okay, aired in the daytime. Now, they are all revolving around some domestic subject. Okay, brothers' problems are there, friends' problems are there, saas and bahu problem is there. Okay, so different domestic problem, as a matter of fact, becomes a subject matter. In this way, domestic subject is the subject matter for the television. And television's significance is sometimes the act of watching television and of choosing what is watched can itself play an important role in culture of a home. Now you see, sometimes some family do watch certain teleserial regularly. So it again gives us aspect of this choice, okay, or a particular culture they follow, okay. Like the serial which is liked by a particular family may not necessarily be liked by other family. So obviously there is again a class difference is there. Certain classes will enjoy certain teleserial projecting their class. Certain classes will enjoy certain, you say, serial which are promoting their social culture. So in this way, this difference is always there, and audiences receive, you see, serials according to their understanding and capacities. Then, in case of meaning or drawing meaning from the program, there is one more aspect John Fiske discusses in this book, and that is gossip and oral culture. Now you see, sometimes some serials are so popular, like it started being the talk of the town, okay, and then gossips have emerged out of it. Sometimes you see some serials are there, like Sex and City is a popular American drama or serial is there for many years is being aired. So in this way, this is serial based upon some gossips. So some gossips are the subject matter for the serial, but at the same time, serials become subject matter for the gossips. Okay, so in this way, gossips helps popularize a particular serial. This is what John Fiske's observation. So teleserials, I mean, prepared in such a way that it gives a scope to the viewer to gossip or gossip making. And in this way, oral culture is responsive to and is part of immediate community. It resists centralization and the ideological control that goes with it, and it promotes cultural diversity. So at the same time, you see, these teleprograms helps promote cultural diversity. Okay, now here we need to stop halfway, and we are about finished half of the book. We have discussed a very important aspect of this book. Now, remaining part of this book we'll discuss tomorrow. I hope you'll join me, and tomorrow's session will be based on the remaining part of the book. Okay, now I'm inviting your questions. If you have any, we'll discuss.